Thank you very much for doing this, Mr. President.
I'm delighted to be with you, Jonathan. Thank you.
And you have spent so much of your public life, so many decades, defending and championing human rights. What's different about the case you're making now?
Well, the abuse of women and girls in the United States and around the world is worse than any other human rights abuse I've ever known about. The volume of it, the intensity of it, the deaths that are resulting, the mutilation of human bodies, the deprivation of respect, all of these things take place not only in the United States but around the world.
People will be startled, I think, by you putting so much blame at the feet of religious leaders, but they will be startled as well by your blaming the United States as well. And I'm quoting this, I hope you won't feel it's out of context.
No, go ahead.
But you say in the book that part of the problem is, and here's the quotation, a tolerance of violence and warfare following the example unfortunately set by the United States.
That's correct.
Is America to blame for sexism worldwide?
Partially, yes. Well, you just have to look at some of the other things that take place that directly relate to women. Military commanders still have the authority, despite the efforts being made in the U.S. Senate recently, to stop any sort of prosecution of a man accused of sexual assault within the military. So, year before last, in 2012, we had 26,000 cases of sexual assault. Only about 300 ever resulted in punishment of the rapist. That's about 1%. And we have the same thing on all the university campuses.
Take a country like India, society of laws, a lot of instincts and progressive efforts in constitutional reform and legal reform there, and yet it's still a country where girls are sold into child marriage,
That's true.
Into slavery.
That's true.
If you're president of the United States, or if you're advising the current president of the United States, should the United States be pushing other countries, even other democracies, to do more?
You know, there have been two international laws passed by the United Nations that give every country a right to intercede in other countries if women's rights are abused. One is the Convention on Eliminating All Aspects of Discrimination Against Women. It's called CEDAW. And China and other countries have ratified this convention. The United States has refused. And there's another law, that's the International Violence Against Women Act. And that gives the United States the authority, in fact, the obligation. If another country is abusing women unnecessarily, then we can use economic persuasion and so forth legally in international law to encourage them to revise their ways. This is the kind of thing that the United States could do, correct our own mistakes, which I've already overemphasized maybe, but also to acquaint us with the ability under international law to intercede favorably for women in other countries.
Pressure on democracies like India, on non-democratic allies like Saudi Arabia, pressure around the world, is that what you advocate?
Exactly, yes, I am, in a proper way, but you have to be clear yourself. And we found one thing that I emphasize over and over in the book, that you take a bunch of people from Atlanta, Georgia, from the Carter Center, and we go into 80 different countries all in the rural areas, and it's counterproductive for us to go in and preach to them about we are right and you are wrong, you need to change your ways. So what we do is work side by side with the women who live in those communities to convince them that they have basic human rights.
Jimmy Carter, at age 89, you've become a feminist?
I hope so, yes. Well, my wife and my daughter and my granddaughters all, I think, would be willing to say, at least at this point, that I'm one of the feminists of whom they're proud, yeah.
President Carter, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure. Good questions. Thank you.